Welcome to CertBlaster. In this session, we'll look at the comptia Security Plus SY0-401 and a few practice test questions. In the questions, green highlights a correct response and yellow is an incorrect detractor. Here's your first question. By sending Annie an email posing like it's coming from one of her vendors, Mike, the evil hacker, gains access to and infects Annie's PC with a virus. After gaining access to her machine, he realizes that he does not have the type of sensitive information he's looking for. He does, however, find a document of hers containing contacts for the vendor she uses. He edits the document by adding his contact information, email, phone number, included under Fast and Efficient Malware and Virus Removal Services. Within a couple of days, Annie calls Mike explaining that she suspects she has a mysterious virus on her system, asking him if this is something he can fix. What has Mike done in this scenario? There are two correct choices mixed in with the detractors. And here they are. A full explanation will follow the list. Your choices are social engineering, using a victim's natural tendencies to gain their trust or give out information. Reverse social engineering, use social engineering in a way that the user thinks is their idea. Piggybacking, tailgate or follow closely so that two people appear as one to security devices. Malware propagation. Spread malware with or without user intervention. Phishing. Gaining sensitive information by posing as a bona fide entity. Vishing. Phishing over a telephone. Mike turns out to be an efficient hacker. Using a two-step process, he was not only able to infect his target, he was also able to convince the victim to look to him for a solution. This user is putty in the hacker's hands. Examining the events, we can see a cleanly executed phishing attack, followed by changing a document on the victim's PC to enable phase 2, reverse social engineering. By adding himself to the list of trusted virus removal technicians, Mike can easily get the victim to do whatever looks reasonable to her, which could include running any special fixes or programs. So we know the correct responses are reverse social engineering and phishing. Looking at the others, there is social engineering, which is manipulating an individual to perform actions or to divulge information that is confidential and would not ordinarily be shared. Then there's piggybacking. As the name implies, it's gaining access to a site by following a properly credentialed individual so closely that they appear to security as a single entity. Two for one, if you will. The uncredentialed individual now has free access to any unrestricted area on the premises. A vishing attack uses a telephone to fish. Malware propagation is a generalization of all the different methods of malware transmissions that could be and are humans, number one by a long shot, virus, spyware, adware, ransomware, general malware, trojans, and backdoors, just to name a few. And here's your next one. Which of the following is indicated when a company needs to implement a block cipher with an encrypted key of the smallest size? 3DES, triple data encryption, or triple DES, RC4, which has multiple vulnerabilities and has been relegated to insecure status, AES, which is the Advanced Encryption Standard, a symmetric encryption algorithm, RC5, which served as the model for AES. When examining the encryption types shown, you'll find the most common types are block ciphers and stream ciphers, and the key types are either symmetric or asymmetric, in which case symmetric keys are smaller, where stream ciphers encrypt data one byte at a time by default. They can be configured to handle larger units. Block ciphers are configured to process one block of data at a time. All of your choices are block ciphers with the exception of RC4, which is a stream cipher deemed insecure. AES uses variable length symmetric keys of 64 bits as opposed to 3DES at 168 bits, and AES, which is between 128 and 256 bits. Twofish uses 128-bit keys. Of your choices, RC5 can produce keys up to 2,040 bits, allowing you to tailor it to your needs. A 32-bit key, for example. And one more. A security administrator is using a packet sniffer to diagnose a server authentication problem. The administrator discovers unauthorized traffic on port 389. What protocol does this indicate? LDAP, Lightweight Directory Access Protocol. LDAPS, Lightweight Directory Access Protocol Secure. Kerberos, a strong authentication protocol. TACAX Plus, which is Terminal Access Control or Access Control System, which is a Unix-based authentication protocol. You've been given a valuable bit of information, the port being used. LDAP uses port 389 by default. LDAPS sessions can be secured by using SSL or TLS and take place over port 636. LDAP is used to authenticate users, so you may find a brute force attack type generating high volume traffic on this port. There will always be a nominal amount of traffic from normal user logins at peak periods, but what you have to watch for is high volume off-peak traffic, indicating an attack. You can reduce your attack surface by prohibiting anonymous logins and blank passwords. The default port 88 is used by Kerberos. And finally, TACAX Plus uses port 49. Be sure to check us out at CertBlaster.com for additional free learning resources and subscribe to our YouTube channel for more free videos like this one.